whether it's for environmental reasons, supply reasons, security reasons, we have to transform our energy system to something different. And this is a very, very complex system that will take lots of time and a lot of capital to get right. What's exciting about what we have this afternoon is the fact that we have the leading institutions that are here to lead the process of innovation in this industry. The United States is not going to stay on top based on resources, based on low-cost labor. We're going to stay on top based on our ability to innovate and create new ideas, create new businesses. And if you look at the last 20 years of what's happened here in the Bay Area, it's been driven by the universities as the underpinning of that process. And I think the same thing is going to happen in energy, and it's great to see that these universities have really embraced that view of the world. So that's why we're excited.
Great.
So I'm Lynn Orr. I'm the director of the Precourt Institute for Energy at Stanford University. And it reflects the activities that have been going on in Stanford over the last 7 or 8 years that have really tried to bolster what we do in the energy space. And it's really based on the idea that energy is absolutely fundamental to the way modern societies function, that it needs to be accessible and secure and sustainable and cost-effective. And so we have a very big energy system now. It's going to take a huge effort to change that. We need to bring the best talent we can to work to bear on that set of issues. Now, I know at my institution, and I'd be willing to bet big money that it's also true at UC Berkeley and at MIT, that our students are really interested in this set of ideas. There's no shortage of energy resource in the world. Think about the sun. But we have to have ways to convert that into the services that we all need to take advantage of in a way that's that we can build a huge energy system to go with that. So that takes talented people working on the fundamentals of the energy conversions from sunlight to electricity, on better batteries, on more efficient use of energy throughout the whole system. And on the economics and policy and regulatory structures that make all that happen. So we've created an energy institute that's an attempt to work across that spectrum to build on a bunch of good work that we have that's in the disciplines but also works on the interdisciplinary side as well. And it really comes back to making sure that we can put our students to work on something that really does matter to all of us.
So I'm Dan Kammen, and I'm a professor at UC Berkeley, where I direct something called the Renewable and Appropriate Energy Lab, just about half focused on developing country issues and half focused on developing country situations. And then also our Transportation Sustainability Research Center, where we do some basic research, but also a lot of practical projects with a fleet of fuel cell vehicles, a fleet of plug-in hybrids, a fleet of electric scooters, et cetera. So what we do is we try to have sort of deep research programs, like Lynn mentioned, in a number of topical areas, but also to make sure that there is enough cortical connective tissue so that we can be interdisciplinary about these projects. And that's really what's neat about Berkeley. There has been efforts, like my home department, the Energy and Resources Group, for decades now, but there's now this whole set of things, and every university that's sort of gotten with the energy game has figured out different ways to put it together. But we have students coming out of classrooms, piling out, factor of 10 increase in enrollment in many energy classes. So there's lots going on this. I also serve as the director of the policy chapter of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change's Renewable Energy Report, which is coming together right now, just in time, we hope, for Copenhagen. And in that role, I get the other side of it, which is sort of what Lynn mentioned to begin with, and that is we need to not only innovate, but we need critically to scale up. And we need to scale up dramatically. We've unfortunately frittered away a lot of very good years by not acting. And so we need to scale up and get it right, really without missing a pitch. We need to get a price on carbon. We need to find ways to develop the markets as well as the technologies for low carbon and energy efficiency and really critically energy efficiency solutions. And we have a lot of units around campus based on those. And this IPCC chapter is actually going to be the first time there is a internationally accredited effort, not just an individual researcher effort, that devises zero carbon scenarios for 2030 and 2040. So that's really trying to put all this neat brain power, interesting innovation. Stanford has gotten a very large investment in clean energy efforts. Berkeley received a $500 million one from BP. There's a number of these sort of big efforts that need us to think about how they fit into the wider economy and how these things can be profitable as early as possible, with the least carbon solutions being the ones that are benefited the most as we transition from the fossil fuel to hopefully the fossil fuel free, or the fossil fuel but with managed emissions economy. So our institutes at Berkeley have a whole bunch of foci on that, on the economic pieces, on the technology and science, and it's fun to kind of sit right in the middle of that.
I'm Fredy Moniz from MIT, where I direct the Energy Initiative. We're finishing the university statements here first. And many of my statements would certainly be in common with those of Lynn and Dan. Let me add a couple of additional points. One is, I think that it's interesting to remember that the energy industry, this is for context, the energy industry is very, very massive capital intensive. It's an industry that has, I would say, historically valued reliability and low cost over innovation. And now, as has been stated, we face, however, the need for an unprecedented pace of change of the energy system. And that in many ways defines the innovation challenge as one that involves technology innovation, policy innovation, and business model innovation, all having to come together to affect the kind of change that's been discussed. And so right off the bat, the need for all those forms of an innovation system characterizes certainly what we are doing at MIT, and I believe as well what's happening at the other universities. So all the schools are involved, science, engineering, architecture and planning, management, humanities, huge numbers of faculty and students. We have about 20% of our faculty at MIT, for example, engaged in our energy initiative. And this is what it will take to accomplish the job. I also would emphasize that the task at hand involves both innovating around what you might call today's technologies, advanced coal conversion, carbon capture, advanced nuclear systems, as well as focusing on the transformational technologies that today do not have large market shares. For example, certainly at MIT, solar energy is our flagship program. I'll also then just make a last comment relevant to perhaps part of my history and the next speaker, Dan Riker's history of having served in government. And note that also from our university perspective, the role of government will be very, very important going forward. And I would say in three areas. One is the government must, in some sense, condition the marketplace for this low carbon future. And as Dan mentioned, pricing carbon is the leading example of how the government must condition the marketplace. But secondly, the government needs to play a new kind of role in advancing technology R&D, research, development, and demonstration. And I believe this year has been very encouraging from that point of view, as we've seen the Department of Energy with new programs. ARPA-E is one of the ones recently announced, for example. But with one caution, I also want to add, while these new programs have given an enormous boost to new science, new technology in energy, new pushes to startup companies, and commercialization, universities getting engaged in new ways in the energy innovation business, one caution is that much of this has been funded with the stimulus package. And so we're going to have to see what happens after these next 2 years, because what we need is not a drop, but a further increase in R&D funding commensurate with the task at hand. A third role of government is to provide, in some sense, the conditions for innovation. Some of those involve the ability to marshal financial resources, but also it involves the ability to harness and marshal human resources. That's where universities have a special role. And once again, I would say government has done a good job in many ways in helping us to have our students engaged. But there are other issues, including things like the classic problems of visas, et cetera, that also come into the whole human resource equation. So it's a very interesting time. Our universities are extremely active and engaged, but the government is going to have to continue and, in fact, grow its role for not only us, but for the whole innovation system to prosper over this next critical decade.
Thanks, Ernie. I'm Dan Riker. This is Dan Kammen. I'm Dan Riker. I'm from Google, where I direct climate and energy initiatives. Google's in this energy space for a variety of reasons. One, we're a fairly significant user of energy at our data centers. Secondly, we're quite interested in the engineering aspect of energy, so we've got engineers working on various products now to help people manage energy use in their homes, for example. Also have made a series of investments in energy technology companies, and also working quite hard in Washington on the energy policy front. The focus today is energy innovation, and energy innovation to me means a real pipeline that starts with basic research, that moves to applied research, that goes from there to demonstration projects, from there to the scale-up that Dan Kammen talked about, and from there to full commercial deployment. It's a long pipeline, and to be very honest, we don't do a very good job in this country of moving technologies through this pipeline. We're on again, off again at several steps, and we haven't put in place what it's really going to take to move technologies from early conception all the way to full deployment. And if we don't succeed at that, number one, I don't think we're going to solve the climate crisis. Number two, we're not going to gain the economic and security benefits that are there for the taking when it comes to clean energy technology and the literally trillions of dollars that are going to have to be spent in the U.S. and worldwide to rebuild our current energy infrastructure. One of the main things we're going to talk about today at this session is, in fact, what it will take to move through this energy innovation pipeline. And as Ernie has said and others have said today, first, it's dramatically increasing our D&D spending. We don't spend enough in the federal government. We don't spend enough in the private sector moving clean energy technologies forward. Secondly, even having succeeded our D&D, there's that third D, deployment. And we also don't do a good job of providing what it takes to get projects built at large scale, massive megawatts, massive gallons of output. And we've really got to put things in place to do that. You're going to hear a little bit about, for example, the Clean Energy Deployment Administration, which is in both the Senate and the House bills right now and being debated. That would be a strong mechanism in combination with radically increased R&D spending to the tune of $15 billion a year on the federal side. Those two things would be very, very helpful. We also need to build a smarter and bigger electricity grid if we're really going to deploy technologies in a serious way. We have a dumb grid, and we don't have a grid that is extensive enough to harness the renewable energy technologies that people are so excited about. And lastly, the fourth thing I think is the critical role that federal standards and incentives play. The states have done a good job of putting renewable portfolio standards in place, incentivizing efficiency. But unless this happens at the federal level, we're really not going to drive these kinds of technologies in the way we need to. One quick example is solar thermal technology, the big mirrors in the desert. It is, in fact, the federal government that got those early demonstration projects built. It is, in fact, renewable portfolio standards adopted by various states that are pushing that forward. And of late, it is, in fact, federal help with financing that are finally getting commercial projects built in this country. So those policies are coming together. We do have some examples, but we need a lot more if we're going to succeed.